If you write software that accepts user input, rule number one, never trust that user input. That could be a very dangerous and expensive problem for you to solve. Instead, we should always validate that input before we pass it along to the other parts of our code. That's why in this video, we're going to learn how to apply validation to our ASP.NET Core Web APIs. Now, we've already spoken about what the structure of our recipe's resource looks like, but we actually haven't spoken about what makes a valid recipe. What properties are required? What properties need to match? Are there date requirements or expiration requirements? We need to be able to apply some of these validation rules to our code. One way that we could do that is by making use of some of the built-in validation attributes inside of .NET. So as you can see, I could use the required attribute or the max or min length attribute. I could use the email attribute, or I can actually even specify my own custom validation attribute if I wanted to. And after we've validated our resource, we need to be able to report back those errors to the client. And as it turns out, there's a spec for that. It's called problem details, and it's defined in this RFC 7807. Now, this defines a very common, uniformed way that we could report errors back to the calling client. And luckily for us, it's already built in and implemented inside of ASP.NET Core, so we don't have any work that we really need to do. So why don't we head over to Visual Studio and see how we could use some of these things. To get access to those built-in validation attributes, we have to add a using statement and include the system.componentModel.dataAnnotations namespace. And you can see that's what I'm doing on line 3. Now we can apply those validation attributes to the properties of our recipes record. On line 13, you can see that I'm making title required. On line 19, I'm also making ingredients required. Now, based on your API and your business rules, you might have other validation logic that you want to apply to your resource. Let's head over to the Swagger UI, and I want to look at the post operation. If you recall what this does, it accepts input from the user that it's going to use to make a new recipe. Notice how when I hit tryout, it pre-populates some of this information from us, but for the sake of this demo, I'm just going to remove these. Now when I hit execute, I get a 400 level status code, which means it was a bad request. And if we inspect the request body, I can see some details about those validation errors. Notice it says the title field is required, an ingredients field is also required. The format this is returned to us is based on that problem detail specification. As I mentioned before, these validation attributes are one of many options for applying validation logic to your code. I can even make use of something like the model state property that's inside of the controller class. I can implement iValidatable objects, or I can even make use of some of the open source frameworks that apply validation. Now stay tuned, because in the next video, we're going to learn how we can update resources using JSON patch.